Okay, hi, I'm Paul Henderson. I'm the owner and founder of Erosion Solutions. I found this company back in 2019. A little bit about the company. We are the erosion sediment control contractor. We specialize in filter slots and silt fence. We're operator of stowable, and our company mission statement is to protect the environment at a great value. So some of the products that we offer are the filter socks. They are a filter log. They're usually made out of compost or wood chips. And then some of the services we provide are site prep. We do installs of all erosion and sediment control products. So anything from erosion control blankets to silt fence. We're pretty niche in filter sock and silt fence installs. We are set up well to do lots of it in a day. Silt fence and filter sock can get anywhere from, depending on conditions, 600 meters to 2 kilometers of product installed in a day. We also do a bit of removals and grading, whether it be tree removal for site prep or silt fence removal of old sites. We also do a bit of grading that comes along with that. We have some blower truck applications for our larger silt sock sizes and tear seating. So we do anything from a 200 mil up to a 600 mil sock, depending on conditions. And then erosion control blankets for unstabilized slopes. So I'm gonna go over a couple filter sock installation methods and situations where they should be used. The picture right here is a perimeter control. This is one of my favorites. Instead of doing a silt fence in certain areas, this is more advantageous to your site, especially on this one. You can see we have the orange safety fence for keeping the public out of sight, and then we have our 18-inch filter sock there staked in to filter any runoff. Silt sock usually, or filter sock, is usually more or less maintenance. Once it gets filled up halfway, you just clean it out and you're good to go. Whereas silt fence, you've all seen under wind load or whatever, gets ripped apart, or somebody in a bulldozer isn't paying attention, runs it over. You run over filter sock, usually you fluff it back up, or you cut a new piece, lay it in the damaged area, and stake it in. And then we also have, we're using it in high flow areas and slope stabilization. First pictures, more so a slope and eruption to protect the graded and vegetated ditch. And on the left side, we have a rounded outlet. So we used a triple stack 300 mil to make up the height, but you get better filtration because you have two barriers instead of one going through. This application I really like. Instead of retaining walls, you get we call it a living wall. Is you would take your compost filter sock that's seeded, so you have seeds actually in the sock. You get roots going into your native ground, holding that wall together, and then also the roots growing from sock to sock, holding the socks together, keeping everything nice and tight. You would also put like a geoweb around that to hold it in and stake it into the back wall. Works really well, keeps slopes stabilized well. And then inlet protection, I know in the last presentation there was a bit touched on that when Brett brought up there. We've used this a lot on our job sites. It works really well. Keeps everything outside of the drain, and then if you have water that ends up flowing over because you have sediment built up, you can just dig out around that sock, get the water flowing back through the sock, and filter that water. And then in high flow areas with lots of sediment, put a filter bag or some filter cloth, wrap the tops of your catch basins, and then any water that's flowing over, if there's not so much maintenance like in winter, this is a great solution because if nobody's out there to check it, you've got overflow, you're double covered. And then one that's very popular to see a lot on job sites is check dams. They're great for slowing down your flow rates, catching sediment along your swales and keeping sediment out of the ocean. The biggest thing with these is slowing down the rate of water, because that's the more more water picks up speed, the more sediment's gonna grab, and it's gonna carve out your swales that you've already done real nice. Everybody's been on a job site where you've gone and done some work, and you've had a 20 mil rain event, and it's ruined your work, and this just helps mitigate that. So, the usual or standard has always been kind of rock check dams. They do work in some applications, but the biggest thing is installing them right, and a lot of contractors won't. They won't put the geotextile on the inside to give that extra barrier to catch the sediment. And then they're always left on site, they're never cleaned up properly. You always get, you know, rocks in your, or gate pieces of gating really in your graded areas. So I just wanted to highlight here some pros and cons of silt fence versus filter saw. Filter saw's a lot more robust, especially in damage, if it gets damaged, which happens all the time. And in this picture, it's pretty obvious. In high flow areas, you're better off to have filter saw, as your water will keep flowing through the saw, as where it gets the fence, it gets a certain load, it's gonna keel over and pull apart. So yeah, it works much better in these areas. It's much more long lasting and easier to install. Silt fence, you've got to disturb the ground, you've got to dig it in to do it properly. Filter saw, you lay it on the ground and stake it in. You can usually reuse it. Some areas where it's underwater, it's a bit heavier to reuse, but if you've got a strong back, there's no problem in using it. Okay, so I'm just gonna go over a couple installation methods here. So these are staking methods. So the first one would be downslope. So you have your filter saw interrupting your slope, and you have your stakes along the backside. This is great for like a temporary use, because you're able to cut the saw up, move it. You know, if you did 100 meters on site and now you're cutting a swale later, you can cut that saw that's been used for your slope interruption, line it in your ditches, and you're good to go. When you're staking through the saw, that's more of a permanent, when the saw's being more permanent on site. This is a great job because it keeps a lot of ground pressure and keeps the saw tight to the ground. Unfortunately, sometimes it's not reusable depending on your, you know, distance of staking, which is usually half a meter to 2 meters depending on the situation and the ground type you're working in. In a sandier situation, you want to be more stakes when you're going through it, just so that the water's not able to burrow under. And you can also put some wood chips in front of your saw to have to stop that burrowing, and usually the water will stop, soaking the wood chips or a bit of sediment will be caught in that. And when it does start to burrow under, your wood chips or compost tend to fill in those gaps. One method that I developed with SCS, the consulting group, was that we've been doing stakes on either side, alternating on each side of the saw, and then baler twine wrapped around the stake over top of the saw to the next stake. And then the idea behind that is keep even ground pressure. And if you have undermining, you can go in, tap the stake down, and that baler twine will pull the saw down into those depressed areas. And then the cross over top, we usually use that if we're doing multiple stack, just to keep that top layer of saw in place. And then the spacing of the stakes really is decided on your type of ground you're working with and your slope. Higher slopes, you're gonna need more stakes. Hold it in place better with the higher flows. And so maintenance for filter saw is pretty easy when compared to silt fence. Once it reaches half height, so if you're using a 200 mil saw and it's 100 mil sediment in front of it, you clean it out. It's 600 mil, you get to 300 mils, clean it out. Silt fence is, you know, relatively the same, but the only problem is once you get up to a certain height, you're gonna have that load on the fence and it is gonna collapse. We deal with this all the time. It's one of our main revenue streams is ESC repairs. So you call us, we come out to site, usually rip out fence and replace it, put in new stuff. I'm always begging to, you know, replace it with filter saw because it's less for us to go out and replace more stuff. But yeah. So when I started the company, I partnered with the University of Guelph where I studied. Worked with Dr. Basil Mabassi. He was head of the Stormwater Management Association, and we did some testing on our stuff. I won't go through everything. I've got printouts of this at the booth if you guys want to come pick one up. But the one number to highlight is total salt suspended. We were at a 99% removal rate, which is good. And we have our flow rates over there on the far side. So I'm going to go into when you use compost, wood chip, compost filter sock versus wood chips in your filter sock. Compost is great because you have those microorganisms living in the filter sock that will break down pathogens, heavy metals, organic materials. It does a really good job of that. The compost is going to be heavier than wood chips. It's going to do a better job of sitting in high flow areas. So if you're doing check dams and a swale that's already got water flowing in it, this is a great spot for compost, just to block those high flow areas. The best way to think about compost for filter sock when you're looking at the areas is if you want to stop water and sediment, as it's not going to have as high of a flow rate. So when you use wood chips, is when you're in areas where you want water to be passing through. You're going to have a bit more gap in between each wood chip compared to compost and the actual sock. That's going to allow for more flow. It's also better for tighter areas where you're not going to get machines in. It's lighter than compost sock. I think a compost sock is about 1,800 pounds on a skid when we make it, and a wood chip one is 1,200 pounds. So you can cut it into sections, carry it a lot easier. It does sound like a lot, but if you cut it into, you know, 10-meter sections, you have three guys, it's pretty easy to carry in. And then just a little summary of compost versus wood chips. We've got better filtration out of our compost sock. It does a lot better job of breaking down the microorganisms and contaminants, and can be used on most situations. The wood chips is lighter, easier to manipulate, it has a higher flow rate, and is usually more cost effective for just on the removal side. On the removal side, because usually you're able to split the, and with compost is you're able to split the sock open, spread it out on site, and then take away the actual sock mesh material. Wood chips and compost will break down easily and be a part of the environment. Okay, so if there's any questions, take them now. If not, you can find me at the back middle, and we'll answer them there.
Yeah, so if you go, this is